Hey, it's Bea, and I've got Caroline here with me today.
Hey, everyone.
You see, Caroline and I like to compete in pretty much everything we do.
Oh, like how I read more books than you last year.
Yep, and how I'm a faster runner.
In those cases, we could simply compare our statistics to see who was better. But now we have a bigger challenge. We want to know who is better at their sport. The problem is that I bowl and B plays golf. Completely different sports with completely different scoring.
Yeah, so how can we compare our statistics to see who's the best athlete in their respective sport? Let's explore that today and maybe get to the bottom of this debate. When comparing performances, test scores, or even measurements, we need a way to see how a value in one distribution compares to another in a different distribution. Simply looking at raw numbers won't always tell us much. A higher score is better in bowling, but a lower score is better in golf. That's where Z-scores come in. Instead of just looking at the numbers themselves, Z-scores show how unusual or exceptional a value is compared to the other values in a dataset.
A Z-score tells you how many standard deviations a value is above or below the mean. Calculating a Z-score is just what it sounds like. First, we see how far a value is from the mean by subtracting the mean from the value. Then we divide by the standard deviation to find the Z-score. For example, the heights of adult giraffes are approximately normally distributed, with a mean of 5.5 meters and a standard deviation of 0.24 meters. Take a moment to sketch this distribution in your guided notes. Label the mean and three standard deviations on both sides. The mean, 5.5 meters, should go in the center of the distribution. Then we can add and subtract the standard deviation to label the rest of the distribution. And look at that! You've already used the concept of Z-scores. The value 5.74 is one standard deviation to the right of the mean. Therefore, it has a Z-score of 1. Similarly, 5.02 is two standard deviations to the left of the mean, therefore it has a Z-score of negative 2, and so on. What about a giraffe that is 5.8 meters tall? We calculate its Z-score by subtracting 5.5 from 5.8, then divide by 0.24, giving us 1.25. So the Z-score for a giraffe that is 5.8 meters tall is positive 1.25, which means that the height of this giraffe is 1.25 standard deviations above the mean. What about a giraffe that is 4.84 meters tall? Pause now to calculate and interpret the Z-score for the value 4.84 meters. This giraffe has a Z-score of negative 2.75, which means that the height of this giraffe is 2.75 standard deviations below the mean. What about a giraffe that is 5.5 meters tall? Well, that would just be a Z-score of 0 because the value is equal to the mean. Now that we know how to calculate Z-scores, what else can they tell us besides where a value falls relative to the mean? Similar to the IQR method for identifying outliers, we can use Z-scores to help us identify unusual values or outliers. While there's no single rule for determining an outlier using Z-scores, values that are more than three standard deviations away from the mean are often considered extreme. Why three standard deviations? Well, remember, when data is normally or approximately normally distributed, we can use the empirical rule to approximate probabilities. The empirical rule tells us that for normally distributed data, about 99.7% of all values fall within 3 standard deviations of the mean. That means only about 0.15% of values fall above or below 3 standard deviations, making them very rare. Identifying when values are extreme is crucial in inferential statistics, where we analyze claims and make inferences about populations based on data from a sample. Z-scores also allow us to compare values across different distributions. When we convert values to z-scores, we're transforming them into a special kind of distribution called the standard normal distribution. This is a normal distribution that has a mean of 0 and a standard deviation of 1. That means any data point, no matter where it came from originally, is now being measured in terms of how far it is from the mean, using a common unit, standard deviations. This allows us to compare values from totally different contexts, even if they have different units or spreads, which is exactly what we need to compare our golf and bowling scores. So now that we know about Z-scores, let's compare our results and find out who is actually better at their sport. What information do we need in order to calculate our Z-scores? Well, we'll need our respective scores, the means we are comparing those values to, and the standard deviation. My golf score is 78 strokes, and the scores for this same type of course are normally distributed with a mean 90 strokes with a standard deviation of 10 strokes. Caroline's bowling score is 165 points, and the scores are normally distributed with a mean score of 157 points and a standard deviation of 12 points. Take a moment and calculate our Z-scores on your own. Using the Z-score formula, it looks like Caroline has a Z-score of 0.75, and I have a Z-score of negative 1.2. Based on these Z-scores, who is the best at their sport? Take a moment to think about it.
Well, I think that settles it. I'm the better athlete.
Wait. Since my Z-score is higher, that must mean I win, right?
Not so fast, Caroline. Remember, golf has different scoring rules. For bowling, a high score is better. But in golf, a lower score is better. So while your Z-score is 0.75, my Z-score of negative 1.2 is actually further from the mean in the more favorable direction.
Okay. Looks like you win this round. I concede.
That's right, but don't worry, Caroline. We've still got our weekly chess match coming up, and we'll see who's the better chess player then.
Let's take a look at our key takeaways for today. Today you learned that a Z-score tells you how many standard deviations a value is above or below the mean, and it can be calculated by subtracting the mean from a value, then dividing by the standard deviation. You also learned that Z-scores are useful for identifying outliers and comparing values across different distributions. Make sure you finish up your guided notes before moving on to the lesson activities. Then, complete the online practice. See you next time! Hey.